Welcome to Down with the King from Seize the Gap Fantasy Football. I'm Jamie G. Esquire, the fifth MD master of surgical arts. He's Magnum Mills, and he owns a calculator. We're two dudes from the Joe Blow Football Show who are here to break down the big Super Bowl showdown slate on DraftKings. Magnum Mills, are you as excited as I am, baby?
Yeah, absolutely here. And what we've got for the most part is because you only have the one game. So the big contests on DraftKings are all going to be the showdown captain contest form. There, what you have in that format is you have one guy, captain, who gets 1.5 times the points that everyone else does. He also costs more money than all the other players in your lineup do. Add two together, most points wins. Pretty straightforward, but because you are only picking six players from one game, there tends to be a lot of overlap. So really what you have to do here is be careful in the contest you select and the way you structure your lineups. There are going to be a few plays that everybody likes for good reason. If you play all of those plays, you're probably not going to win very much money. If kind of that's the way you want to play, you're, you know, just more of a low risk tolerance kind of person, then you want to make sure that you play mostly head-to-head games, play single entry contests, play, you know, something with 100 people in it. Don't spend a lot of money in the big contest. If you want to try to make some real money, sure, you can go ahead and, you know, throw a few when you will at their big contest, their Super Bowl Millionaire Makers, a $15 entry. You can try. And again, I'll throw a couple bullets into it. But for the most part, I think the way that contest is structured, the payout is so top heavy, unless you're going to really be willing to run a full 150 lineups, you know, really, really put the work in. I would rather spend my money elsewhere. Like I said, don't get me wrong. I'll throw a few in there for fun. But if you're playing that contest especially, you are going to want to do some weird shit with your lineup. Cashing here isn't going to really do you anything. You have to get to the very top of the board to do it. And a lot of times in these contests, because again, such a small field here, there's a lot of split pots here. Sometimes it's, you know, you and your closest 1,248 buddies are tied for first. If you want to have a real chance here, you got to take some chances. So that's what we're going to talk about. And again, this should be for entertainment purposes only. Don't be playing with any more money than you could afford. And for the most part, in a contest like this, I would rather try to play. If I had $100 to spend, I would go find the $100 single entry, and that's what I would play. I wouldn't try, again, unless you're going to play a full 150 lineups or something like that, in which case you don't need me to tell you this. Go ahead. Otherwise, stick to low single entry, maybe 3-5 entry max contest. And I would generally just play one lineup, play the biggest bullet you can shoot, high caliber shit. Hope you hit it. That's your best chance to make some decent money here. And we're going to break down how you would actually do that as far as the players you want to select.
Quality information right there from the mathematician, Magnum Mills. We appreciate you and we appreciate the info, my man. Now, do you want to dive right into our favorite players, or is there anything else you want to touch on here, Magnum Mills? And you can touch on it if you want.
Ooh, so that's kind of like a Busta Rhymes kind of like 80s weird commercial reference that works for me. I think the thing that most people are going to do, it's maybe not average, but even a lot of people, when you sit down and make your DraftKings lineup, when you go, you know, pick your captain or whatever, we have a big four, I'd call it. You have the two quarterbacks, Matt Stafford, Joe Burrow. You have their top targets, Cooper Kupp, Ja'Marr Chase. A lot of people are going to probably play three of those four, or at least try to, based on the pricing structure. Doing that, especially while playing one of those as a captain, is very, very difficult. So what you have to do is figure out if you want to play one or two of these very expensive guys, how do you want to do it? And how do you do it in a way that's going to be different than other people do it? And again, this is a, you know, normally you would have some correlation. All right, you're going to play Kupp, so you play Stafford, run it back with Joe Mixon, and then you fill in the blanks. That's fine. But so many people are going to be doing that. That's not going to work. You're going to have to do, just be a little bit different again, unless you want to play a smaller contest or whatever. Sure. Play it more safe, correlate the best you can, knock yourself out, get access to these high-end guys. if you're going to play some of these bigger contests and try to really get some leverage on these fields, you're going to have to do some different shit. And I think it starts with how you attack those big four players. So I would say my question to you, Jamie G, is there at least one of those four guys you feel like you got to get in your lineup?
Man, yes. I feel like I have to have, I have to have Cup. I just know he's going to get a touchdown. Like I know, I don't know if it's going to be worth it, but he just usually does Cooper Cup shit, even though every team tries to stop him. I just feel like I have to have him. I'd rather almost have him. You know, if it's like gun to your dick, you got to have Jamar Chase or Cooper Cup. I'm taking Cooper Cup. Here's why. I like T Higgins. I actually like the Burrow stack with Higgins and or Boyd rather than the Burrow Chase. It's just, once you do that, you're just really handcuffed. And same thing with the Stafford Cup though. It's dangerous because of how expensive they both are. I also like OBJ here, if you can get them. So some sort of combination, but if I'm forced to take one of the big four, I have to take Cooper Cup. I have to.
So we know what you're doing over there. You're playing the Cooper Cup at captain, then you're putting your boy Blanton in there, and then you're figuring out the rest.
It's got to be Blanton, dude, all day. So I mean, look, we'll dive into it. Don't you guys worry. We're not gonna whip it out just yet, but we got some surprises coming for you here on Down with the Kings. Magnum Mills, how should we approach a running back position in this game? Very interesting spot.
It really is, because Joe Mixon seems to be the most obvious running back play. But on the other hand, two of the better punt value type plays on the board are Samaje Perine and Chris Evans. I guess you could say all bets are off the board a little bit if Daryl Henderson plays. I believe he's at 1,600 in a flex spot. That would open things up. But even if he plays, again, it's still probably a three-way between Michelle and Akers and Henderson. So it really comes down to that, who's going to get the passing game work. I think it would be Akers. I would probably put Henderson over Michelle there. So I guess maybe if the Rams fell behind, there's some universe where Daryl Henderson gets four or five targets, which could be valuable at that price point. But man, I think realistically, the way would probably be Cam Akers. If you're going to go somewhere at the captain position, especially with a running back, I think because he's got that question mark next to him, he's coming off the Achilles, a lot of people are going to hesitate. He's going to be pretty low into that captain spot. The Bengals defense has been very bad against the run for most of the season here. Akers looked pretty good. Everyone forgets he went up against two very good run defenses in the Tampa Bay Buccaneers and San Francisco 49ers. I'm willing to probably give him the benefit of the doubt here, especially because playing Akers at captain at that cost under like AK, so like 7,600, I believe, that opens up a ton of options for your lineup that you're just not going to have if you start with one of the big four at your captain spot. Yeah, running backs, Cam Akers, this is one I would say at the running back position, make sure you're checking in on this at least late Friday, Saturday. Obviously, you should have time. Super Bowl starts later on Sunday. Make sure when those inactives come out that Henderson is inactive, that Akers is active, that kind of thing. That will all matter. And I also would say that one, you know, we'll talk about him as a punt play later, but Chris Evans for the Bengals at $600 in your flex would be interesting to play with the Bengals defense, because he is a kick returner for them and a pretty good one. And so while, you know, we're talking a little bit about the, you know, the DST there for the Bengals, Jamie G, do you have any feelings about possibly playing a kicker or defense in the captain spot? We've seen it almost come through here, and most notably, I believe, a Thursday night game with the Dolphins against the Ravens. It can pay off, and that's one of the few ways you could open up enough salary to play, say, three of those big four guys. So you got any feelings about playing your kicker defense in this game, a captain?
I absolutely do, and I'm going to be max entering in some of the some of the less expensive games here, and just getting my beak wet there with going with a bunch of different variations. I like this here with two ways to look at this. One, Shooter McPherson, baby. I'm talking about if he gets four or five field goals, two or three extra points. Two or three of the field goals are 50 plus. I mean, you could see a universe in where this isn't a bad situation and allows you to play literally everyone. I mean, you could probably get the big four in there and then it's nuts. So I do really like that. It just opens up a lot. The other side, I like the possibility of the Rams here. Okay. Something tells me the Rams front four is going to feast on Cincinnati Bengals offensive line. That is a matchup where I cannot talk myself out of being all in on the Rams defense. And what matters, okay, when we're talking about using them in a captain spot, is sacks and turnovers. And I could envision a world where that front four gets, I don't know, 6-7 sacks on Burrow, maybe more. Maybe one of them's a hit while he's throwing it and Ramsey or one of the guys gets a pick. Like, I could see it happening. So Shooter McPherson and the possibility of the Rams D could be interesting for me, and something when I'm digging deep, I'll probably run a couple lineups with each of those in the captain spot.
Yeah, I got a couple lineups with those in there. We'll get to that maybe a little bit in the show when we break out some lineups, maybe, and just talk about how some of these things will actually work in the real world once you start plugging somebody in at the captain and you start spending this money, how these lineups form and any way you can differentiate yourself. I'm actually going to kick this one back to you, Jamie, because I think you have a stronger feeling here than I do. And the last thing we really haven't talked about here is the tight end position, because both Rams starter Tyler Higbee and Bengals starting our boy CJ Uzama have MCL injuries. Both are claiming they're going to play. I think it's really touch and go. Maybe there's a chance we know they're out Thursday or Friday, but I think realistically, both could be, honest to God, you don't know whether they're playing or not until you see the inactives on Sunday. Even then, you could see one of these guys being active and not really playing, or just maybe playing four snaps in the red zone or something like that. So, Jamie G, how are you approaching the tight end position here? You don't have to play one, but they might be some of the better values on the board.
Dude, I got a guy out here that I'm pretty high on, and I actually, you know, I watched this happen. It was interesting. In the conference championship game with the Bengals, CJ Uzama, our guy, who is a featured weapon now, went out in the game, and they replaced that production with T. Higgins and Joe Mixon. Yes, they missed him, but you saw where they went with the football. It wasn't another tight end. Now, subsequently speaking, when the Rams in their conference championship game, they lose Higbee. They did not go to increase volume for Kupp or Beckham. Everyone still got their same touches. They replaced the production with my guy, Robert Blanton. That's right, Blanton. Blanton snuck in for a touchdown. He was targeted, I think, 4 or 5 times. He's getting some looks. I like him here at a tight end play. He's priced like he is going to get volume. That's the only thing I hate about this. He's priced at $4,600. I think last week, what was he, Magnum Mills, $600 or something? $1,600, something like that. But I mean,
$1,000 in the flex, I think. Yeah, pretty cheap.
So, but I like him here because they've shown that they go to him when Higbee's out. They're not going to not utilize the tight end position. And last week, Cincinnati didn't utilize the tight end position when CJ Uzma went out. Matthew Stafford and the Rams still utilized it, and Blanton was the guy. I like Blanton. He's fallen into several of my – I definitely got exposure to Blanton, dude. I'm not afraid to say it.
I think that's definitely a spot where you're going to have to refer to the injury report. Like you said, on the Cincinnati side, it's going to be hard for me to be excited about Uzama if he plays. He's not coming super cheap, and there's a good chance he's very limited, even if he's out there. Drew Sample flashed for a minute. I believe he's a former second-round pick. Just not seeing it. Maybe you get the random touchdown there. Odds are you don't get enough salary relief, I think, to go there on the Bengals side. And on the Rams side, I like your argument for Blanton. The problem is in that similar area, you could go to, say, Van Jefferson, and I could see him just as easily being – the recipient of those few extra targets, or maybe even it's a Sony Michel or a Daryl Henderson or someone out of the backfield that gets a few of those there. I almost might rather go with, if I'm going to go with another Rams tight end, go down to Bryson Hopkins. I believe it's 600, 800 in the flex there. Same kind of deal. He might only get 2 targets, but if one of them is a touchdown, again, when you get those, you know, basically min salary guys, I just think, given all the stuff on the board, the only problem is, again, it'll be ownership. If either of those options are popular, I'm out. Because it's just not really going to work off, especially Blanton. You know, if he's, say, you know, I don't know, 20, in the low 20s-ish or something, I can live with that. If he's 40-50% owned or something, that's just too rich for my blood overall.
Agreed. I will say this, though. Cincinnati has struggled against the tight end position, and I just look at the Rams saying, look, we went to him before, he delivered. We're not gonna say we can't attack a weakness because we got Blanton. So that's the only point I'll make on my boy. We'll talk to him. Talk about him, I'm sure, again, as this podcast evolves. Magnum Mills, I think it's now time for the hook. Watch out now. The big toe. I'm talking Derek Jeter. The crunch It's time to break down our picks for the captain position.
Thank you, Captain.
Thank you, Captain.
Thank you, Captain.
Okay, Captain.
No, Captain. No,
you, Captain.
Thank you, Captain.
Enough with the captain shit.
Get out of here.
No.
Captain, my captain, dude. And we already kind of started on this. So I think right away here, it's what we broke into a little bit before, but just do it a little bit more in depth right now. So Jamie G, let's say you're playing 1-3 lineups. You're not out there playing, say, 20 max. You're just doing a 1-3 max here. Are you playing any of the big four in your captain spot? If so, who is it?
Look, you know, if I'm going to do it, it's going to be Cooper Kupp. It just is. I don't want to. I really enjoy getting outside of those big four. It's a lot more fun for me. It allows me to feel better about my lineup, and I don't feel like I'm in a position of weakness as I'm trying to fill positions five and six, you know, as I get to the bottom of my roster here. So if I absolutely have to, and I decide to, for me, it's going to be Cooper Kupp. There's just no way in the world the guy has the season he has and he doesn't deliver in this game. I just don't see it.
So I would piggyback that into, if you're playing Cooper Kupp, are you definitely putting Matthew Stafford in there to flex?
Yes.
So then once you do that, then you're probably going to say, all right, you're playing that at least one more Rams pass catcher then, because that makes sense because you already got Cooper Kupp in there and the captain. You got Matthew Stafford. So you're getting down there. Are you playing your boy Blanton? Are you playing Van Jefferson? You may be looking at maybe even Sony Michel. Who are you doing there maybe for that third Rams pass catcher option? Because paying up for Beckham seems probably a little bit untenable at that point.
Cannot pay up for Beckham, especially if you want to be able to get a T. Higgins, or heaven forbid a Joe Mixon at $9,600 here in the flex. I'm going Blanton. I said it before. I really am taking a flyer on him here. The only other thing I would consider doing here instead is maybe taking the Rams defense in a flex. You know, Blanton, Jefferson I like, but he's been banged up and he is totally a Bob.
Davis a little bit though, and we've seen kind of that guy. He does have that deep threat. We've seen him score those long touchdowns.
We have, but lately it seems like that guy's been Beckham. It seems like he's found a rhythm there, and Jefferson's been a little bit of the light. I don't hate the play.
I wouldn't be playing Van Jefferson, say, at my captain spot, but if I'm playing Stafford either at captain or in the flex. The interesting part about Van Jefferson is I think he's priced up enough that he still has upside because he's not too expensive to be used, you know, that you don't want to use him, but he's expensive enough that given, like you said, his underperformance recently, he's too expensive for most people to feel comfortable with. So I think he's just in a weird zone, especially because the lineup combinations you're going to get when you put him in there, most people will want to either go pay off for Beckham or do something cheaper or even go with Blanton. So I think you're going to get a fairly unique lineup structure by putting him in there. And I don't think he's, you know, again, everybody is going to catch some ownership here. When I say like, no, I'm talking like less than 15% or something. But I think relative to what his upside could be, you know, catches a long 100 yards and a touchdown or two. I think that's a legitimate thing, especially if Higbee's out. And I think relative to that, he's going to be under-owned. So he's a guy that's probably going to be worked in there for me a lot if I'm going to use either Stafford or Kupp. Because again, like you said, most of the time when I'm playing Kupp here, I'm probably going to play Stafford, especially in these, you know, smaller single entry, 3 max, 20 max. If I'm going to dip my toes into something bigger, yeah, I might play Kupp naked up top or something like that with like a Rams defense, something along that lines.
Absolutely. And another guy, Magnum Mills here on the Cincinnati side of the football here is Tyler Boyd. Tyler Boyd has been a guy that at times has delivered quite a bit. At times he's outdone T. Higgins. T. Higgins still feels to me like somebody who's going to get more of the targets. But given the way the Rams defense is, I could see maybe Tyler Boyd being a guy that wins his one-on-one. And you know, maybe Joe Burrow goes to him a little bit more here. So I don't mind Tyler Boyd. I think it's a 2,000 and change savings from Higgins. And, you know, I really think I've been talking myself out of Shooter McPherson for 3 weeks. And I'm finally saying, you know what? Why am I talking myself out of it? And again, we talked about the Rams defense. So, you know, the one that I probably won't go with here is Cincinnati's defense special teams, and maybe shame on me a little bit. They've created turnovers in, you know, all three of their playoff wins. They created turnovers, right? They had a turnover, I think, in that Raiders game. They definitely did, you know, three in Cincinnati, two last week. Shame on me. Maybe we should be looking a little bit more here at $3,200 at Cincinnati's defense. And then again, it would be interesting to pair Cincinnati's defense, as you mentioned, with Mr. Superman, Chris Evans, who I believe is $400 in the flex and returns their punts. And guess what? He's pretty damn good at it.
Kicks and Captain America, but close enough. And it was actually the difference between T. Higgins and Tyler Boyd at captain is not nothing. It's $3,300. A captain, T. Higgins, cost you $11,400. Tyler Boyd, $8,100. Again, I think it's one of those weird things where I do actually like what Boyd can do, especially if the Bengals do get down early in this game and Uzama is out. There's a lot of target potential there for Boyd. But again, everyone's going to be looking to save dough. So I'm expecting you're going to see Boyd be quite a bit higher owned than T. Higgins because you have to pay that extra money. And again, if you're playing a smaller field kind of deal, single entry or whatever, more about Boyd. I think you could even consider playing Boyd to captain because of the options it opens up for you. And at that price point, if he gets that, say, 100 yards, get the bonus touchdown, doesn't have to be a long one, I think that gets you close enough to it, especially because then you can play Burrow with him. You could probably play him without Burrow and Chase or Burrow and Higgins even. You get that much savings opened up by doing that. And hell, I mean, in something like the Millie Maker, I don't think a lot of people are going to do there. So if nothing else, it'll lead you to a different lineup structure than a lot of people are going to have. Because I think most people who play Tyler Boyd are going to play him in their flex, most likely where they're playing, you know, either Burrow at their captain or probably Chase at captain with Burrow, and then they're running it back with Boyd because they get all that savings from Higgins. So by playing Boyd to captain, you're going to, you know, make yourself unique, but you still have the opportunity to get exposure to Burrow and another one of his receivers if you want.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, Burrow is an interesting play for me. You know, when you think about him, is he, it, you know, I always look at it and it's like, okay, well, is the quarterback, you know, is Burrow going to be captain or nothing here? And I'm not convinced that he has to be. I think like you said, you get creative, you put, you know, if you're building out a roster thinking Cincinnati's going to put up points and give us fantasy owners what we want, and we're going with orange and black here instead of, you know, the Rams, then, you know, having Burrow in the flex works, I think, a lot. And same thing with Stafford. So really interesting there. Magnum Mills, what do you think about Matthew Stafford? Talk about Burrow. Hit me with a little Stafford juice.
I'm really Natalie Imbruglia here, which if you're not old enough or too young or whatever, congratulations. I do it because I worked at a store and they played it on the radio all the time, which you listened to back in the day, the radio. And it's
Torn
by Natalie Imbruglia. It's your mom or your older sister or somebody likes it. Ask them. The question is,
nothing's wrong. You're torn.
It's quite all right. I'm torn. I'm all out of faith. I'm into something real now. And
the little things.
Something real is, you know, Matthew Stafford, and you can see, again, I picked him before the season to win the MVP. I think he can get it done here, and this is one of those things almost, especially because there's not a big price difference here. You got the Cooper Kupp at 17-4, Matthew Stafford 16-2 to be in that captain spot. I think most people are going to go with Kupp there just because of the season he's had, and that's one of those things. I like them both. Do love the Kupp, but if Matthew Stafford was going to say be, I don't know, 15-20% less owned in the captain spot, I will be more interested in Stafford. He's a guy I'm going to get in a lot of lineups, especially because it's really tough to see the Rams winning this game without him doing something. I do think the Rams are going to win ultimately, but I don't think it's going to be some kind of laugher or something where they're just handing the ball off to multiple running backs for the back, you know, Cooper, you know, Stafford throws for like 240 and two touchdowns. I don't think that's happening, but, you know, I don't know if he's also going to go out there and rip it up for, you know, and wind up with 60 pass attempts or something, but he could. It's just more of a question. If he does that, and Cooper Kupp gets 200 yards and two touchdowns worth, then you probably want to play Cooper Kupp as your captain. So that's the 6 and 1 half dozen another. I think it's a little bit tougher for – I like the Rams defense better than the Bengals offense kind of in this scenario, especially with the defensive line. So I think the game script is going to work in a more positive favor for the Rams, which makes me tend to go towards Joe Burrow here, because if you think the Bengals are going to be down, they're going to have to come out in the second half and just let Joey do his thing. And we've seen when he does that, he can let it rip. So that's kind of the way I would be going with this. That probably makes me lean towards Cub a little bit more than Stafford, and then maybe running it back with Burrow on the other side. Again, 6 and 1/2 dozen the other. That's the point of why we're talking about these big four guys so much, because it seems I don't think there's any way you can win without playing at least one. I think the winning lineup probably finds a way to squeak two in there. There's a world we can get three. Four is not feasibly possible, really, without people getting hurt. That's why it's kind of how do you probably find the right two to play. So that's really, I think, what we're talking about here.
Totally agree, Magnum Mills. What about the running backs, man? We talked about them a bit at the beginning of the show, but are we willing to play either of them as captains? I mean, you talked about Akers, and while I agree with that, I do like Mixon at the captain spot, though, man. I've toyed around with a couple of lineups here, and putting him in the captain slot, while it's not cheap by any stretch of the imagination, it's a big savings from when we're playing one of the big four. And I like the fact that I go back to this, man. Mixon, the offense for Cincinnati goes through Mixon. It didn't matter that they're down 21-0. They're handing the football off to Joe Mixon. They're using him in the screen game to slow down the rush. I like Mixon's use, man. Will he have a 3-touchdown performance? Probably not, because I don't think they score enough touchdowns here for everyone to get their due. But I do see him, you know, putting together maybe 89 yards on the ground, another 35 through the air, and maybe one touchdown. And if he does that, I'm not mad about playing him in my captain spot at all.
Yeah, and it's not just because I'm from Philadelphia or that they just rebooted the fresh bits, but sometimes you have to take the, you know, the game, turn it and flip it upside down. And that would be, we're talking about the Rams winning, I think, in most scenarios so far. But what is the game where the Bengals wins look like? If they say get up early, Mixon gets in the end zone, and they get Stafford to turn the ball over, it's happened. It's not impossible. God forbid, say Andrew Whitworth re-injures his knee or whatever. There is definitely a world where you could say put Mixon in your captain, put the Bengals defense in there. You've already got some nice savings. You can then put Cooper Kupp in there. You have enough room to, if you want to play Burrow or Stafford, you can. You want to put Jamar Chase in there, you can. And you can still round it out with, say, a Cam Akers, a Sony Michel, a Van Jefferson, a Tyler Boyd. So that mix in, you know, say, and that's the same thing I'll say too. If you want to build a Cam Akers lineup, that's one of the few ways. If you play Cam Akers a captain, you can jam in three of the big four. And you can, again, if Akers winds up being healthy and plays basically as a four down back, and you can play him, say, with Stafford and then run it back with Chase and Burrow still, you know, that's a hell of a thing. And again, I think the big four are going to soak up so much of that captain ownership that it's really worth thinking about playing one of these running backs at the captain spot.
That leaves us with the dynamic duo Cooper Kupp and the rookie phenom. No, we're not talking about Method Man. We're talking about Jamar Chase. What are we doing with these guys in the captain position, Magnum Mills?
Cooper Kupp is probably hanging with himself, because he is both like Kupp from Transformers and Mr. Cooper from Hanging with Mr. Cooper. He's like that cool that he's a Transformer hanging with Mr. Cooper. I would rather play him than Stafford. I think I would rather play him than Chase. I think overall, from just a pure whatever, dollar for dollar, you're doing a projection standpoint, he's my favorite captain, because we've seen him, I mean, 12 receptions for 220 yards and 2 touchdowns, maybe 3 touchdowns is legitimately on the table. I mean, just a super monster of a game. On the other side, you can look at Jalen Ramsey, who's lobbying to cover Jamar Chase, and given the price points that you have T. Higgins and especially Tyler Boyd at, I think there's other ways you can go on that Bengals side. So I greatly prefer Kupp at captain to Chase, prefer him slightly to Stafford. Burrow might be my second favorite there, but again, I think that's because you get in a game script where if you think the Rams are going to get up, Burrow's going to have to throw the ball a lot, and he's been very good for fantasy owners in those situations.
Look, y'all, I swear, this isn't nearly as complicated as we're making it sound. You can do this. You can do it. And trust me, this is way more fun than just having to root for two numbers in a boring-ass Super Bowl squares pool. Don't get me wrong, those are cool, but this is definitely leveling up. For more help having fun and banking some serious cash, make sure that you stay tuned to Down with the King and all of the content offered by Seize the Gap Fantasy Football and the Joe Blow Football Show. Magnum Mills, tell the people where the content lives. Where is its home?
Well, I mean, what? Why won't you go in your home, dude? What's wrong with your home? Shout out to, you know, Shooter McPherson and that Happy Gilmore remake. And if you want to see things like we think of about a Happy Gilmore remake with Shooter McPherson, that's all from the Joe Blow Football Show. You can find it at joeblowfootballshow.com on social media, Twitter, Instagram, all the fun ones, all the good ones at Joe Blow Show. We're Down with the King from Seize the Gap Fantasy Football. You can find our podcast by searching for Seize the Gap Fantasy Football or Seize the Gap FF on your favorite podcast streaming platform. We're again on all the good social media stuff at Seize the Gap FF. You want to be down with the king. You want to be efficient. You want to seize that gap. You want all of these things. And we can help you with it because we're cool like that. And remember, you think that it is. It is. If not, it isn't.
This is Ben, Down with the King, part of the Seize the Gap Fantasy Football Podcast, presented by the Joe Blow Football Show. We are not in any way, shape, or form affiliated with DraftKings. This show is for entertainment purposes only. Any views or opinions expressed here are personal and do not represent those of people, institutions, or organizations who may or may not be associated with the Joe Blow Football Show. If you have any questions, please contact us at seizethegapff@gmail.com. Thank you for listening. Please remember to like, subscribe, and comment.